faceless comedy. Hardy ha, hardy ha, hardy ha ha.
So who does he make pregnant but the babysitter? So now he doesn't know whether to stay with the wife, the sister, or run off with the babysitter.
When's his next confession?
Tuesday. I'll keep it posted.
I mean, the recording nights were always brilliant fun. I mean, you know, like Dermot and I could never really keep a straight face, you know.
Go on! They put in some very physical stuff for Mrs. Doyle to do, and that was always a complete thrill.
One of my fondest memories was a stage direction written in all earnestness by Graham and Arthur. It says, "Caution, it is extremely dangerous to approach Father Jack."
Wake up! Fake off!
It's so nice to be associated with something as cool as Father Ted. British people see it as this kind of surreal, wacky comedy. And, Irish people see it as an amusing documentary.
Everything about Father Ted was unusual. It was a British sitcom set in Ireland, written by two Irishmen. It had a cast of unknown actors in a less than promising setting, a gloomy parochial house on bleak, craggy island, home to three weird Catholic priests and their balmy, tea-obsessed housekeeper. Father Ted was also unusually funny.
It's a beautiful day out.
Me ass.
Would you like it? Manual or automatic, Father?
Automatic, I think. It's a nice day. Might as well take it easy.
Fair enough.
Arthur Matthews and Graham Linehan first met when they both earned a living on Dublin's Hot Press magazine. Linehan as a journalist and Matthews doing page layouts. Matthews was also part of the mock U2 tribute band, the Joshua Trio, which introduced an early version of Father Ted Crilly. He's the man in black.
I used to introduce the band as Father Ted, who was a kind of generic priest, but different from the way Dermot ended up playing him. But he used to come on and say, "Hello, this great band coming up. If there's anyone at the back who can't see, say hello to them, because they're from St. Finbar's School for the Blind in Navan."
When Ted made a career move from warm-up priest to sitcom star, Arthur Matthews' knowledge of the character provided divine inspiration.
He would have the voice handy. So whenever I needed to know, you know, what Ted might say or something, Arthur would just say it, and it would be very easy to write that character.
By the end of the 1980s, Linehan and Matthews had left Dublin for London and had set their sights on television. The long list of writers' credits at the end of a Smith & Jones sketch show convinced them that they could do that sort of thing too. So they sent some in. Bravo.
One.
What's he saying, man? Wink. Yes, I think it's wink. Gregorio?
Si.
You seem to be tagging on a wank there. Can you try it again without wank?
By 1994, the word was out on Linehan and Matthews, and they were in regular demand to contribute to the best and most groundbreaking shows like The Day Today. In tune with the humour of the time, they were also head writers on the all-new Alexis Sales show, before striking gold with their creation of that sad oasis in the middle of the farce show, Ted and Ralph.
It's just I have a couple of tickets for Tina Turner.
All right, sir.
Do you like Tina Turner, Ted?
I wouldn't know about that, sir.
No.
The Fast Show's producer, Geoffrey Perkins, rose quickly through the satirical ranks. After writing for Spitting Image, he went on to produce Ben Elton's series The Man from Auntie and, among others, Harry Enfield and Chums. Although Graham Linehan and Arthur Matthews could clearly handle sketches, they had yet to be given the chance to write a full-length show. They went back to their roots and pitched the idea of a mock documentary about a priest's reunion to Geoffrey Perkins.
Firstly, I just thought, well, this isn't obviously
something you could ever sell, because who wants a one-off documentary about a parody Irish priest? But there was a huge amount of invention there. And I got in touch with the writers and said, have you thought about doing this as a sitcom?
It was while they were fleshing out Father Ted for Hat Trick Productions that Linehan and Matthew's first sitcom appeared on Channel 4, an historical knockabout vehicle for Alexis Sale called Paris.
Mrs. DeGou, what are you doing?
I'm gonna kill you!
You sold some paintings!
You always loved that idea of an artist who's just tortured by his own genius and can't have a cup of tea without, you know, going into spasms.
I thought you'd cut off your ear.
No, I had toothache. I was wearing a bandage thing, you flying bollock head.
Oh, I see.
Paris was critically mauled, and Linehan and Matthew's career looked to have prematurely stalled.
We couldn't read the newspapers for 6 weeks because the reviews were so bad. And, you know, you think that's it. You think, oh, well, we're done for.
But the writers then risked further punishment by turning Father Ted into a sitcom. Now they had to convince the man who'd bought Paris, Channel 4 commissioning editor Seamus Cassidy, that Ted had legs.
Paris stiffed very badly. It got not very good reviews and it got lousy audiences. And there was a wee bit of pressure about giving another series to two writers who weren't that experienced and weren't that well known.
Probably it was about as hard a sell of a show you could ever have, which was, let's do a show which is about a group of Irish priests on an island off the west coast of Ireland. Oh, and by the way, it's going to be acted by people you've never heard of. It's a fantastic pitch.
Holy Mary, Mother of God!
The main fear I had was that it was too Irish. And it took Jeffrey and Paul Mayhew Archer, who was our script editor, to convince me that both being impeccably English, they still found it funny. But I didn't have any problem with commissioning it because the scripts were just laugh out loud funny, and it's very rare, even with good comedies, that it lifts off the page like that.
How long has Father Jack been living in there?
He started just a few days after you left.
Maybe he's agoraphobic.
Jack scared of fighting? I don't think so, Ted.
After 3 years in development, Father Ted was ready for liftoff. With one failed sitcom to their names already, Linehan and Matthews had it all to prove. Father Ted was riding on a wing, a prayer, and 10 Hail Marys.
The main thing we did was think of funny situations and embarrassing situations and stupid things and characters, and then we'd try and get them into a plot. And it's surprisingly easy to get funny scenes into a plot and just crowbar them in. It seemed to work quite well.
Dougal, look.
Oh. I am Chinese, if you please. Oh, no, no.
Come on, Dougal, lighten up.
I think the only person who had an absolute belief that this show was going to be a huge hit was Dermot Morgan.
Former teacher Dermot Morgan made his TV debut in Ireland doing stand-up on the live mic in 1979. By 1985, he had his own show, Getting Morganised. And in the early 90s, his brand of cutting political satire was heard on the RTE radio show Scrap Saturday. But Morgan's humour could make even the unflappable Gay Byrne uncomfortable.
Many songs are sung and written about Emmett, Pierce and Towan, but no one knows that son of Ireland who loved to chew a Bowen. A patriot so fearless who fought doggedly for his nation. Not a Catholic or a Protestant, but a bloody big Alsatian.
He'd been kind of taken off TV and his radio show was upsetting a lot of people, and he'd kind of burnt his bridges in Ireland, Dermot had, really, unfortunately as well, you know, because the Irish TV and radio was very conservative, and Dermot was making shows that were, you know, ruffling people's feathers. Then Ted came along at a perfect time for him. It was just absolutely the vehicle to launch him again in another country. So we did a first audition with Dermot, which was bad. It's not really, he was very nervous. I think he came over to England, just tried too hard, and Dermot wasn't an actor. He was a huge charismatic person, but he wasn't really an actor. It was quite hard for him.
Just play the f***ing note.
First one.
No, not the f***ing first one. The f***ing first one's already f***ing down.
I have never come across anybody so desperate to do something. You think if you're that desperate, probably you ought to do it.
So I
just play the f***ing note you're f***ing playing there. The f***ing you were just f***ing doing. Play the f***ing note.
Ardal O'Hanlon was at least hitting the right note on stage. In the early 90s, he established himself on the stand-up comedy circuit. Father Ted creator Arthur Matthews was a fan and was convinced he'd found his Dougal.
My name is Ardal, and I know quite a lot, and I'm going to tell you some of the stuff I know. Condoms, for example. They're a disgrace, aren't they? Condoms. They're useless, and they're ineffective, and they burst. And your stomach just can't cope with the sudden impact of 2 kilos of cocaine.
I got a call from Arthur one day saying, why haven't you turned up for auditions? And that was the auditions for Father Ted. So I said, all right, I'll come in. And I went in and they gave me some paper to read and I read it. And then a little while later, they said, would you like to be in a sitcom? And I said, fair enough. And that's really it.
Hello. Father Dougal McGuire here. And welcome to this week's Top of the Pops.
I hadn't heard of Ardal, and the guys were banging on about Ardal for some time before we saw him, and when he came in for the audition for Dougal, I didn't get it. I thought he was awful.
Yes.
July 19th. I wouldn't know, Ted, you big bollocks.
But what was fantastic when you look at what he did with it, you know, the character is stupid.
I said, I wouldn't know, Ted, you big bollocks.
But he didn't play him stupid, he played him innocent and naive and childlike. So it's like having your 10-year-old kid with you all the time.
Have you been reading those Roddy Doyle books again, Dougal?
I have, yeah, Ted, you big gobshite.
I think it was Ardal's performance that may have been the first thing to pull people in, because Ardal's face, when he does Dougal and his face relaxes into that Dougal mask, is very, very funny.
Who? Oh! He's been what?
I have got a note from Channel 4 saying, are you absolutely sure about Ardal? And I remember writing back saying, I'm not sure about anything to do with the show, but the one thing I am sure about is Ardal.
You're not going to believe this! Clint Eastwood has been arrested for a crime he didn't... Oh, wait, no, it's a film.
Ardal was a free laugh character that he just had to walk in the room and look around with that weird stare. And, you know, you were quid zen.
Okay, one last time. These are small, but the ones out there are far away. Small. Far away. I forget it.
I felt I knew exactly what was going on in their strange minds, and you know, I felt I really got it, and you know, and just read it in the way I saw fit to read it, and you know, luckily they sort of agreed with that.
Say when,
huh?
Say when,
huh?
Tell me when you want me to stop pouring.
Huh?
Oh, all right, that's it, is it? You sure don't anymore?
Yes.
There seems to be something comedic about me. I've tried very hard to be a straight actor, but I come on and I'm very straight, and then they all burst out laughing. So, really, the only thing to do is to answer the call.
Drink! Fake! Ass! Girls!
One of Ireland's leading stage actors, Frank Kelly, was a familiar face on Irish television. In the 60s, he appeared as Professor Astro in Wonderly Wagon, and later in the satirical Hall's Pictorial Weekly.
Will you shut your bloody mouths and eat your bloody custard?
At the meeting, they asked me, would I shout a whole string of expletives in the most eccentric way I could think of and as loud as I could? And I thought, these guys are really nuts. They're off the wall. They've lost the plot. This can't be a television series.
Ick!
These really do work, don't they, Dougal? Oh, you're right there, Ted.
Ick! Arf!
For Frank is a classically trained actor. You know, Frank's done all that stuff. He's done everything, you know. And so to have Frank in the corner, and you've got a lovely voice, Frank, when he speaks normally, you know, it's a commanding voice. To have this guy, he's a very elegant gentleman, and to be able to destroy his face and cover him in shit and put bogies out of his nose and wax out of his ears, the part was just perfect for him. He was fantastic at that.
Ah, no. Not Toilet Duck again. You know what that does to you.
He didn't have an awful lot to do in the show, so you'd feel a bit sorry for him from time to time.
Now, we're going to have a little elocution lesson. Drink! Now, Father, you can't be saying that all the time when the bishops come here. Fake!
No. But he was always there to offer advice.
Girls!
And, you know, to break the tedium with a story or an anecdote or a song.
That! Drink!
Or indeed a poem.
That! Drink!
Or a sketch.
That! Drink!
Or a tune.
That! Drink! That! Drink! That! Drink!
He is a great character.
Drink!
And the other thing, I used to call it numb buttock acting, because if you got into an uncomfortable position and other people were on camera for 10 minutes, you stayed on that buttock. And that's a very numb feeling. You know when you get caught like that, an angle like that, you think, when will this end, you know?
And what do you say to a cup?
Fake off, cup!
He loves his cup of tea.
Fake off!
There you go.
Fake off!
Pauline McLynn had worked before with Dermot Morgan on his radio show Scrap Saturday. Though an experienced theatre actress, sitcom was something she'd never tried. With a week to go before the Father Ted filming started, McLynn convinced the team she could play the much older Mrs. Doyle and handle a tea set.
I go on, would you not have a drop?
No, thanks anyway,
just
Mrs. Doyle.
Cup.
I'm fine. No, really.
I'll tell you what, Father, I'll pour
seriously.
A cup for you anyway.
Ah!
And you can have it if you want.
No. Mrs. Doyle is, I think, possibly the sunniest natured woman on this earth. She's hardworking. She's beautiful in an unconventional way, we liked to say. And I think she just found her look in sometime during the war and just stuck with it.
I read a bit of one of them once. God, I couldn't finish it. The language, unbelievable.
It's a bit gritty, but that's the modern world, Mrs. Doyle.
Well, it was a bit much for me, Father. Feck this and feck that.
Yes, Mrs. Doyle.
You big bastard. Oh, dreadful language.
There are loads of actresses who've done those sort of Irish housekeepers. And we saw all of them, really. And the trouble was that actually what they were giving you was that really good comic Irish housekeeper. But I think that what Graham and Arthur wrote was beyond that.
I stick this effing pitchfork up your hole. Oh, that was another one. Oh, yes.
I see what you mean, Mrs. Doyle.
Bastard this and bastard that. You can't move for the bastards in her novels. It's wall to wall bastards.
Is it, Mrs. Doyle?
You bastard,
anyway.
You fecker, you bollocks. Get your bollocks out of my face. I'm just talking to my father.
Yes, you just go and prepare for the nuns.
Ride me sideways was another one.
The minute I saw the scripts, I just thought, I know what's going on here. And a few hours later, I got told, don't do anything to yourself. Don't cut your hair. Don't do anything. We think you're it. So that's rather exciting.
Father Ted was a far cry from previous ecclesiastical sitcoms. In series one, we saw Craggy Island's priests at the fun fair, bath time in the parochial house, a protest against pornography.
Down with this sort of thing.
Careful now.
And a good old-fashioned prayer meeting. Here were all the ingredients for a cult classic, but the reviews for Series 1 were mixed.
People didn't quite know what to make of it. It was quite big and broad in its performances, and sometimes that can really send an audience the wrong way, and it certainly can send critics the wrong way.
God, it's lovely out.
I remember reading, this is one of the most predictable shows I've ever seen, so I started to write things down that I don't think you could have predicted. And about 5 minutes in, I'd written down 20 things that I didn't believe you could have predicted. And I reached a point where Father Dougal picks up a pair of binoculars and sees these giant ants in them and puts them down very matter-of-factly and says,
the ants are back, Ted.
And I gave up. I just thought, you're on a different plane of predictability.
But some critics would find the lottery predictable. Luckily, Channel 4's commissioners disagreed, and 10 more episodes popped up like rabbits.
Just a bad dream, Your Grace. Over in the mud. Oh.
Over the course of three series, Father Ted would win several Best Comedy Awards, and the Doubting Thomases were proved wrong.
It's very gradual. It's a very gradual thing. Maybe it's when we won a BAFTA, we thought. Oh, OK. This is good.
Anyway, Ted, let's play a game. Chess or buckaroo? Actually, I wouldn't mind a game of the old chess today myself.
Really?
No, only joking, Ted. Buckaroo.
That second series, they really surpassed themselves in the writing. They were very, very confident at that point. They'd got it. They'd got the characters. The performers had got the characters. They knew where all the gold was.
Ted!
Graham Norton came into the show because I'd heard him on Loose End's radio show.
Easy come, easy go. Will you let me go? Pass me la, no. Will you let me go? Let me go. Pass me la. Will you let me go? Let me go. No.
We cast him and that worked out well, and we brought him back, and it's a character that people like.
Let's have a screeching competition. I'll go first.
Father Noel is very excitable, very enthusiastic priest. With a love of young people and their special energy.
Come on, Tony, sing out your heels into the stars, and you know how it feels to high.
The Father Noel stuff was great because it's just speeches. So I didn't have to do any of the proper acting stuff, you know, listening or reacting or anything. I could just sort of show off, and then, you know, my bit was over. And I mean, Father Noel doesn't listen to anyone. So, you know, my bad acting, you know, I think I got away with it.
Who's that now? Is that Jerry Fields heading off to the disco?
It's only us, Noel. We're just heading out for some fresh air.
Don't forget to bring us back some.
Right, son. Big feckin' idiot.
Father Ted's success can be put down to the expertise of a cast of top stand-up comedians and comic actors, delivering equally brilliant lines. But that mix also led to some friction.
I think it was quite difficult for Frank, who's got a big actor, and a big proper actor, who's playing a character which he just does brilliantly and has huge impact, but basically does say a lot of the time, "Fake arse girls drink." And Dermot, who is not an actor, who is just going through a lot of angst of, yes, sorry, can I just do this? And sometimes you could sense, or indeed hear, Frank in the background just chuntering under his breath about frigid amateurs.
That was one of the brilliant things about the fact that they weren't actors. You know, an actor will give you the same performance over and over again, which is brilliant, and you know it's going to be there and consistent. But Dermot Ardle would go into the studio on a Friday night, and when the audience is there and they're flying, suddenly things would happen, little looks and pauses and gaps in the way they're saying their dialogue and stuff like that. That was just fantastic.
Ah, Dougal, great news. I've been asked to go and work in America.
Really? As what?
as a priest.
A priest! Great! That's more or less the same as what you do here.
During the writing of the third series, Linehan and Matthews took the brave decision to quit while they were ahead and make this one the last. From their original idea for a spoof documentary back in 1992, the writers had seen Father Ted through 25 successful and award-winning shows.
You can't really have more than three series before you start repeating yourself. And in fact, we did start repeating ourselves, I think, a bit. You know, Mrs. Doyle falling out the window in one episode is fine, but maybe not in two, you know. And you're getting into areas where maybe it's time to put them back in their little ventriloquist cases.
The day after filming finished on the third and final series of Father Ted, Dermot Morgan collapsed and died from a heart attack. He was 46 years old.
We were in the canteen in South Bank Studios one day, and Pauline looked out the window and she said, "Wouldn't you far prefer to be in a smelly tennis club hall rehearsing a bad play for poor money in Dublin today?" And I broke my backside laughing because, no, I wouldn't have far preferred. We were living pretty well, thank you.
Frank Kelly returned to drier roles, appearing with Pauline McLean in the costume drama Aristocrats. In 2001, he was among 2001 comedy performers in the sketch show Revolver. Kelly then played Labour Party leader John Smith in The Deal.
During the last few shows, when we were in the studios and we knew it was going to end, people wanted any sort of memorabilia. I mean, Ardal and Dermot would often, in a sort of rock and roll way, tear off their little white priest collar and throw them into the crowd. And eventually, my moles were being offered to them, which was just the most disgusting thing. The makeup lady would come out with a tray of moles and say, would anybody like these? Oh, it's just horrible.
Minus the wandering mole and the teapot, Pauline McLean demonstrated both versatility and dress sense alongside Frank Kelly in Aristocrats. She then played pushy Bella Mooney in Ballykiss Angel, before returning to comedy in the sketch show TV To Go in 2002. After time was called on Father Ted, Ardal O'Hanlon resumed his earlier career hosting the BBC stand-up show. In 2000, he finally consigned Dougal's dog collar to the past, donning red lycra pants to play all-action superhero Thermo Man.
It was a pleasure to save the life of such a beautiful woman.
Well, what do you think?
You are Thermo Man.
Ta-da! We're going to have such fun. Look what I can do!
Sometimes I wake up in the middle of the night and in a cold sweat thinking, my God, what would I be doing now if Father Ted hadn't come along? And if I hadn't got that phone call at the last moment from Arthur, you know, a career dangles from such a slender thread. But yeah, it definitely changed everything, you know.
Having abandoned the priests to their fate on Crazy Craggy Island, Father Ted's creators, Linehan and Matthews, concocted an even stranger brew of sketches in two series of unfettered surrealism called Big Train.
Ooh, very tart.
In 1999, Arthur Matthews and producer Jeffrey Perkins worked together again on Hippies, which only ran for one series. Bummer. In 2000, Linehan and Matthews were back together writing sketches for Chris Morris's latest nightmare vision, Jam. But in 2002, Graham Linehan returned to safer sitcom territory, co-writing Black Books with the show's star Dylan Moran. Arthur Matthews joined the writing team for the second series.
Well, I've worked with a couple of genuine, real, I hate to use this word really, but comic geniuses, really. I worked with Doug Saddams and various other people, and I think Graham and Arthur are there, really. I just think they were a fascinating combination.
It seems to be coming from all around us. The Sioux Indians in the Arizona desert used to be able to pinpoint the exact location of buffalo by gauging the position of the moon and putting their ears to the ground. Actually, Ted, maybe the sound is coming from that stereo.
I think the 90s was just a brilliant decade for comedy, so it was great to be like kind of the sitcom end of that new wave of comedy.
Fake off is a very gentle way of telling someone to go away. I wouldn't say it's anything more than that.
It's like, feck it. It's a word that we all use from a very early age. It's one of the first words we learn in Ireland.
Well, I mean, feck is just fuck, with an E in it.
Is it true that it's in the Oxford English Dictionary now? I think it is, yeah. That's brilliant. There's the legacy of Ted. The Oxford English Dictionary, defiled.
Take off!
Night, Dougal.
Night, Ted.